Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for our 10 Things You May Not Know About Marketing Cloud webinar. Everyone is on mute today, so if you have any questions or you're having any technical issues, please put those in the chat window, and we'll get those resolved for you as quickly as possible. Before we actually jump into this, I would like to share a success story with you about Urban Institute. They are the trusted source for research and insights to help solve our nation's toughest problems. They rely heavily on effective email communications, sending out over 24 email newsletters on a regular basis. They selected to go with Marketing Cloud, and since doing so, they have attained a 99 out of 100 return path sender score. They are allowing their constituents to opt in to whichever newsletters they would like through custom subscription centers, and they have streamlined their communication processes. This is just one story out of over 1,000 Salesforce implementations that Cloud for Good has completed to date. Last year, we did our second annual State of Salesforce within the Nonprofit Sector Report, and found that 75% say that Salesforce has become more valuable, 78% say that it is easier to do their work on the platform, and 96% see innovation potential with Salesforce. This innovation is possible because we can now touch each department within your organization, helping you be more efficient and effective. One of the Cloud for Good advantages is that we are certified across all the Salesforce applications, and we have experience with many applications that can enhance your Salesforce experience. Whether it is a solution to help you better communicate with your constituents via marketing automation tools like Marketing Cloud, or a case management application to help you offer more services, we have both the experience and the expertise. Since we launched in 2010, we've seen tremendous growth. We have been named to the Inc. 5000 3 years in a row. We are a best in the world workplace. We have been named a great place to work by our employees 4 years in a row. We're a Salesforce.org premium partner, and we join the Pledge 1% movement, where we give back 1% of our profit, 1% of our product, and 1% of our time. To date, we've given back over 1,000 volunteer hours and over $147,000 in grants back to the nonprofit community. We would not be able to do this without the best team ever. The people you interact with at Cloud for Good are our biggest asset. Everyone is full-time. We don't subcontract out any of our client-facing work. Everyone has nonprofit experience. We also have quite a few user group leaders and Salesforce MVPs on staff, and you can see just a quick snapshot of all of the many certifications we have across the board. We don't connect you with just the best talent. We also have a proven methodology that helps take you from the evaluation stage all the way to full adoption. We analyze what your needs are, design a plan to meet them, work with you to set up the system to meet your specifications. We then turn it over to you to test and then deploy it to everyone and offer training as well as part of our implementation project. We've also found that many of our clients come back to us for ongoing support. Now that I've given you a brief overview of Cloud for Good, I'd like to introduce our two speakers today. The first one is Julie Workman. She's got over 10 years of nonprofit leadership experience, over 5 years of Salesforce experience, including 8 different Salesforce certifications, which do include Marketing Cloud as well. She has a master's in applied psychology. She's located not too far down the road from me in North Carolina, and she definitely is one of our best team ever members. And then we also have Rob Soblevaro. He's got 6 years of higher ed experience in marketing automation. He's definitely one of our Marketing Cloud gurus. He's certified as a Marketing Cloud consultant as well as Sales Cloud. He's been using the platform for over 5 years. And he's got a master's in communications, and he's located in Florida. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to these awesome marketing cloud gurus and let them talk to you about marketing cloud.
Thanks, Jana. So we are excited to talk today about 10 things you may not know about Marketing Cloud. Marketing Cloud is an incredibly powerful email automation tool, cross-channel communication service, and has a tight and deep integration with your Salesforce instance. So we're really excited to talk today about some of the things that might be new, of interest, or maybe some gotchas along the way. In my prior role, I served as the Director of Technology Engagement and Marketing, and with a team that used Marketing Cloud for lots of email communications. And so I can really appreciate how Marketing Cloud as a tool can be used as a strategic communication device. So Marketing Cloud Connect is the way that we can really tightly weave data and flow data between Salesforce or Sales Cloud and Marketing Cloud. So item number one is Marketing Cloud Connect. Now the Connect, Marketing Cloud Connect is a connected app. This is an app that you install in your Salesforce instance, and that's the way that you create that bridge where data can flow back and forth in virtually real time between your instances. If you've used other email marketing tools, you may have experienced different levels of integration in terms of your Salesforce data. One thing you may not have thought about with Marketing Cloud Connect is that it is on platform. So any new releases from Salesforce, so your Summer 18 release, Marketing Cloud as an on-platform marketing tool is going to not have those hiccups you might experience if you didn't have an on-platform tool. Another thing that's really interesting about Connect is that almost any of your email marketing activities can take place from within Salesforce. So if you have Salesforce users who are engaging using your marketing communications, but they're not necessarily on the marketing team, those Salesforce users can stay right in their Salesforce home where they're happy and comfortable, and via the connector, they can still send those on-brand, beautiful, richly formatted content do all of that from within their Salesforce experience. They don't have to switch over and learn how to navigate Marketing Cloud or know how to create content. They just use that branded rich content from Salesforce. You can do almost everything in Salesforce that you can do in Marketing Cloud, with exceptions being creating content and establishing automations. So when users can stay in Salesforce, that helps us increase adoption and can help increase the volume and richness of communications. So one thing to note is that data flow is where we spend a lot of time in our analyze and discovery phase in understanding how data should move through the system. So a key consideration is, what is your source of truth? Marketing Cloud can actually stand on its own, and out of the box, that's what it thinks it's going to do. It's going to send emails from Marketing Cloud with Marketing Cloud as the source of truth. However, we frequently find that our clients can have more impact by having Sales Cloud or Salesforce as their source of truth and create that 360 constituent view from within Salesforce. So that's where we spend a lot of time thinking through, what does that look like for an implementation? And one other thing you might not yet know about the connector is that it is a connected app. And while Sales Cloud and Marketing Cloud will be, you'll get that new feature functionality rolled out to you automatically, your connector has to be manually updated. It's an important thing to keep in mind. This is a quick screenshot of the connector, and from this instance, from the screenshot, you can see how I, as a Salesforce user, I can interact with an individual constituent, so a contact or a lead, Or I can send that rich branded email content to Salesforce reports or campaigns without ever leaving Salesforce. This is probably one of my favorite things to think through, is how we can track and leverage constituent engagement using Marketing Cloud. So one of the most important things with this concept of tracking constituent engagement is to have a clear definition of what engagement looks like based on your mission and goals. So setting targets for engagement actions. What do you want your goal outcomes to be? We do that a lot in marketing planning and constituent engagement planning. This is where those plans come to life. So how are we going to do that? We're going to represent our targets with specific fields in Salesforce so we can capture that data in a relatable way. And then we're going to actually use Journey Builder to track progress towards our goal and update Salesforce. So we'll talk about Journey Builder more in just a moment, but for right now, this is a very simple example of how you could build out your engagement curve. For some, it's an engagement pyramid or logic model. You're going to actually represent those engagement steps somehow in your Salesforce instance. So in this hypothetical example, we have good old George, and we want to move him from his initial interest in engaging with us. We want to move him up to engagement level 1 and then engagement level 2. And for you, that might be that you want to move from awareness to understanding, then collaboration, commitment, advocacy. What that looks like will be unique to your organization's mission. But what we think through is, how do we represent that in Salesforce? How do we move the data back and forth to Marketing Cloud? And then how do we use Journey Builder to update and enrich our Salesforce data? We do that with Journey Builder. So one thing you may not know about Marketing Cloud is that Journey Builder is really great for whiteboarding. And the reason I really appreciate this concept of whiteboarding is that it allows us to actually start sketching out that engagement plan and drag and drop elements for decision points, splits, joins, what email content are we going to want to send when. That will influence what assets we need to develop or what specific content and language we need to develop. And it allows us to incorporate aspects and ideas from all of our different teams. So we don't always think about having all of these teams in the room when we're doing email design, but when we're talking about Journey Builder whiteboarding, we really are talking about constituent engagement really from level 1 to level 5 or whatever that looks like for your organization. So here's an example. This is a sample drafted whiteboard engagement journey. In this engagement journey, what we want to do is move our friend George from his initial interest in being an advocate with us, and we want to move him through and up the different steps of engagement. And so we can really just drag and drop elements from our Journey Builder user interface, indicate who and when should who should join this journey, when, what does that criteria look like, and filter for different attributes. And then we can just drag and drop actions like send an email, wait for a certain amount of time. Then we can actually have a decision split. We can have an engagement split that says, did someone open an email or click on it? Or, as in this case, that decision split can be configured to actually go back, look at George's Salesforce contact record and say, did we move George from level 1 to level 2? If yes, then actually we can set a goal and we're done with the journey. But if not, we can continue sending different types of communications or creating a task in Salesforce or updating their record to indicate that we want to take different actions. This concept of whiteboarding the engagement journey is very much it makes it really easy for teams to brainstorm together and start to think about what those journeys could look like. Here is a sample subscriber to donor journey that we're whiteboarding. And you can see on the left-hand side where we're our criteria for our entry event is we want a contact who doesn't have any history of giving. So in this case, there's a custom field on contact indicating total giving, lifetime giving. And if it's zero, then we want them in this journey. What are we going to do next? We're going to send a welcome email. You can see right now it's still grayed out. This is a placeholder email where we haven't yet specified the exact content or what email we're going to send, but we know that that's that placeholder for the welcome email. Next, we want to create a task. In this case, maybe it's the major gifts officer where we want to tell someone who is going to be paying attention to this account to set some sort of task for the future. We can then wait and go back and look at George's contact record in Salesforce. And if we now have a donation made, we're going to exit the journey. If not, we might send a different type of content. Wait for a while, look again at that contact record, and if it still hasn't changed to achieving that donation being made, we might send a third email. Now, there's plenty of different things and different activities and actions you can take, but this is an example of whiteboarding and drafting the subscriber to donor engagement journey. I wanted to show you how we set those goals, and you can see that this goal is being set to when total giving is greater than $0. That means that we've accomplished the goal for this journey and that we are declaring that a victory. We've met the goal, and we can identify what we'd like this journey to accomplish overall. So a really exciting thing rolled out in spring of this year. Just very, very recently, we now have a new feature called Journey Builder Templates. These Journey Builder Templates are created, they've populated in Marketing Cloud instances, and they actually create a starting point for you to dive in and begin drafting journeys. So the Journey Builder Templates that are available are Abandoned Cart, Everyday and Significant, Anniversary Send, Birthday Journey with Coupon, Welcome Journey, and Welcome Journey with Engagement. So those Journey Builder templates are out-of-the-box starting points that already have some of those steps drafted, like we were just looking in those at our whiteboarding scenarios. Those whiteboarding scenarios we created in thinking through our engagement plans. Now, the Journey Builder templates, these come out of the box with no knowledge of your data model. So one thing that we like to really think through is that Journey Builder looks super simple. Journey Builder looks sometimes really super simple because you can just drag and drop entry sources, activities, decision splits, joins. You can very quickly create really interesting flows, but it's really the data model behind it, and it's getting all the pieces in place to leverage the journeys. So getting the right pieces and the right strategies for your mission and your goals, that's really where the heavy lifting is, so to speak. So data model, strategy, flow, goals. Those are the areas to really think through and spend some time considering what does that look like for your organization, your goals, and how will you meet them. We'll talk about two examples of how we have implemented Marketing Cloud to meet really specific criteria for specific nonprofits. One was Urban Institute. Jana is just referring to our work with Urban Institute. That little screenshot there is their success story on our website, which you're welcome to check out and learn more. why we found this one to be such an interesting project is that Urban is such a powerful influence, a very powerful research-based work that they do, and so it's so very important that they get their message out. And the, one of the primary ways of distributing that message is through their email sends. So with over 24 newsletters and a very specific requirement that one that any individual be able to receive multiple newsletters at multiple email addresses, but without creating multiple contacts, we created a solution that included a custom object for communication preferences. It included using Salesforce as their source of truth or database of record, a custom subscription center where individuals could opt into one or many newsletters for one or many email addresses. So that use case is that's a use case that's not out of the box available in most marketing automation tools. Really, it's usually one contact has one email address, and we're going to send whatever our communication is to that email address. And we can have other fields that have a data type of email, but those aren't system recognized email address fields. So in this case, what we did is we built a series of data extensions, automations, and journey builder journeys that allow one contact to enter a journey multiple times for one send. So therefore, one contact record in Salesforce could have five associated communication preference records, and we could send any number of newsletters to all five of those email addresses, but not create five different contact records. That was a really fun project and a great team to work with. Common Sense Media uses Journey Builder in a really interesting way, and we had talked earlier about how you can configure Journey Builder to update information in Salesforce. So this goes back again to our conversation about where is your source of truth, what's your database of record. And so to maintain Sales Cloud, Salesforce as your database of record or your source of truth means that you push information out to Marketing Cloud, then that Marketing Cloud information has to get back into Salesforce. So the way that happens is through Journey Builder. And so the held subscribers journey is one that we built for Common Sense Media to allow a Salesforce record to indicate that that subscriber's email address has been held in Marketing Cloud. Held is a system attribute that talks about whether there have been a certain number of bounces or undeliverable email attempts. And if that subscriber is noted as held, we wanted to make that visible in Salesforce on the Sales Cloud contact record. So those are two specific nonprofit use cases. And I'm going to turn it over to Rob, and he's going to talk about some of the ways that he's going to talk about the automations and concepts that we use. So keep in mind that when Rob is talking about creating automations, that those can actually be used within Journey Builder, and it's a really neat way to truly tie everything together in a very sophisticated way.
Great. Thanks, Julie. So good afternoon, everyone. So Julie talked a lot about the power behind Journey Builder and your ability to use it as a strategic tool almost in conjunction with Marketing Cloud Connect, using your Salesforce data as kind of the source of truth, and really ultimately becoming strategic with your marketing efforts. You can consider that the brains. What I'm going to focus on now and also touch on some higher ed use cases as well, is more the brawn, the muscle behind automations, where you're not just automating communications, but really you can automate almost everything in Marketing Cloud. So one thing to talk about there is Automation Studio, which comes with Marketing Cloud. Marketing Cloud in general, you can think of it as its own database, essentially, behind the scenes. With Marketing Cloud Connect, you can stream over your Salesforce data and have that readily available in a database format, almost as a copy. But with Automation Studio, you can automate on that data that's coming over. So for example, audience segmentation is a very popular use case for that. So in a higher ed context, maybe you have some recurring audiences that you try to focus your communications on. So maybe people who have applied, or people who haven't applied, or people who are being admitted but still have pending items on their admission checklist. Marketing Cloud can be set up to automatically calculate who those audiences are and take that burden off of you. So you can feel a little bit more confident that every time you send to the same segments, they're automatically being updated and you're targeting the right folks with the right message. And likewise, you have the ability to leverage triggered sends. So taking a look at the Salesforce side of things, based on changes in your Salesforce data, you can trigger certain messages to go out. So maybe there's a certain checkbox on a student's record saying they've completed all their prerequisites for applying to your school. Maybe in an advancement case, a donor has reached a certain giving milestone. You could trigger an email to go out based on those changes to the Salesforce data. So again, really streamlines your processes, and you can take that burden off of the marketing team and putting it on the platform. And expanding our scope a little bit, if we look at file imports and exports, that is something that is totally within Marketing Cloud's wheelhouse. So for example, if you have external systems that manage housing or meal plans, and maybe you want to identify students who haven't used their ID card at the mess hall for the past 2 days, you could bring in files from external systems and link them up or join it with data in Marketing Cloud, and then subsequently use that to better segment your audiences. And likewise, if there's reporting data within Marketing Cloud that you want to export, that's available to you in an automated fashion as well. And you could do a lot of sophisticated calculations. One good example is limiting the number of emails you send daily to subscribers. Part of any good communication plan is being strategic, but maybe you just want to put a bulk limit on how many times you touch a contact in a given day. Marketing Cloud can do the math for you, and it can literally do math with things like geolocation questions, or calculations rather. If you have zip codes for your contacts, you can perform calculations to see who's within a certain radius maybe of a certain zip code and really get super targeted in your communications. And there's so much more. Really, the limit is your imagination. If you can think of how to manipulate it in a database, Marketing Cloud could likely accommodate that for you. And even if we go a little bit deeper, Marketing Cloud provides the means to programmatically interact with your data. And what does that mean? So Marketing Cloud has its own programming language called AmpScript. And essentially, it allows you to look into all that data that's being brought into the platform, whether it's from Sales Cloud or file imports, and look up those specific bits of data that are related to your contacts. So things like how many times their emails have bounced, or maybe their latest gift, maybe the latest SAT score that they submitted to your school. Really anything that lives in a database that is joined to your subscribers, AmpScript can look it up on the fly. And what this opens up is the ability to dynamically query data and adjust the content of your emails in real time. So for instance, maybe you have students with multiple applications or donors with multiple gifts. You could find the right record at the right time and adjust content in your email by choosing to display it or hide it, all using AMP script. And the inverse is also true. As you start sending emails, maybe you want to log some data or update a certain record in Salesforce. You can do that as well with AMP script and insert data directly into the database. And maybe using Journey Builder, sending that data back over to Sales Cloud and keeping track of it that way. So it's a very powerful extra layer by which you can manipulate data, manipulate the content of your email sends, and it really demonstrates the robustness of the platform. Another sometimes underused tool in the platform, which is actually one of my favorites, is approval processes. So it's great to have all these automations and content building tools, but it's really important to integrate it into the business process. So approval processes really does that. It empowers your users to create content. So maybe you have a centralized marketing office or a small marketing team, and you can't do everything all at once. Approval processes is what allows you to scale out the content creation process to more users across the organization. And this can really embed your business process into the system. So maybe advancement officers or admission officers are able to put together messaging using pre-approved templates and images, assets, and so on. But maybe a centralized marketing team or a department head has the final say as to whether an email is ready to go out or not. And that's really powerful because it allows business to scale. If, you know, next year you have way more marketing efforts planned on the calendar, you can distribute that work out and also make sure that your brand, your message is on brand. There's no typos. It kind of allows another level of refinement to your marketing process. And it scales with your organization as well. If you have, you know, a new team that's onboarded, the lift to integrate them into an approval process is very minimal. And this is sometimes just an unknown tool that is not used as often as it could be. It plays really well with Marketing Cloud's Content Builder. There are some legacy customers that still use classic content as well to build their emails, and approval processes are available in there as well. As we move through this, the slide will not show up. Sorry, folks, some technical difficulties. Here we go. So another tool that is often underutilized is measures. And this kind of ties back into the idea of automating and updating our segments. So measures essentially allow you to define something that you'd like to measure, right? So it measures interactions by your subscribers with regards to your email on a one-to-one level. So if you're sending out a big solicitation email for donations or asking students to apply now, you could set up a measure for that particular email and measure which subscribers are really engaging with our email. But it actually doesn't stop at the email level. It kind of goes beyond that. You can go down to even the link level. So if you want to see who's been clicking our particular Apply Now link or Donate Now link, Marketing Cloud can measure that for you. And this really gets unlocked when you do future sends, as you kind of define your funnel of who's your marketing audience. It's not limited just to clicks as well. It can expand rather to opens, who didn't click, didn't open. If you utilize Marketing Cloud's HTML survey tool, you'd be able to measure individual responses. So let's say you sent out a post-event survey and somebody was unsatisfied, you'd be able to target that audience with almost one click with a follow-up email to maintain that level of customer service with them. And measures can actually capture interactions with emails from a six-month time range. So there's a lot of flexibility within there. If we take a look here, I have some screenshots of what the measures actually look like. Essentially, you're able to say, for data source, essentially all your subscribers that receive a particular email from you, identify a certain event, whether it's a survey response or click in an email, and really define further parameters to that. So maybe a particular email that you sent out that had a particular name or subject, or even a specific URL that you wanted to track or answer from a survey. All of that can be captured in a measure. And then consequently, the next time you try and do a send and you're filtering your audience, you're able to drag in that particular measure highlighted in red here and add that essentially as a piece of criteria for your audience, which I think is pretty cool. It allows you to further refine that funnel and make sure you're only talking to the people who may be engaged or unengaged, and then engaging them in a different way later on. So measures is definitely a powerful tool to use. So we've covered a lot of different aspects of the platform, but I wanted to take a moment to kind of put it all together for a higher education use case or two. If we think from the perspective of admissions, recruitment, journeys, as Julie touched on early on, are really powerful. You're able to scale out and provide a personalized and dynamic communication approach to incoming students or maybe accepted students through journeys. And based on their interactions with your communications, you can dynamically adjust your tactics as well. Maybe not engage with the unengaged, or if you're using journeys, maybe switch to a different channel. So maybe emails aren't working and they're unengaged there. Switch to a text message campaign to get them information that they need. If we look at measures, again, you can use those to really funnel out who's engaged and who's not. This is not only important for your email sends as far as sender reputation, to make sure that you're not spamming people who aren't engaged, but really allows you to identify and feel more confident about who your audiences are. And that's an important part of being strategic or becoming strategic, is not taking a shotgun approach, but really becoming more refined throughout a campaign. And then the third piece is reacting to changes in data, whether you're integrating with a student information system in Sales Cloud or importing that data to Marketing Cloud directly. There's always changes in data. Maybe a student is no longer undeclared and they've picked a major, or maybe they changed their major. This is a great opportunity for you to automatically adjust your email content. You don't want to send biology images to somebody who's majoring in English, or vice versa. So you can use all that data that's being automated on in Marketing Cloud to dynamically adjust content. Use things like AmpScript to hide or display things to people in different stages of a recruitment funnel, and so much more. Again, your imagination is really the only limit there. So that'll do it for me on the education side.
Great. Thank you, Rob and Julie. We have some questions coming in, so I'm going to jump into those. And anyone else that has questions, I encourage you to put those in the chat window and we'll get those answered for you. So the first question is, I've heard that Salesforce is now pushing Pardot over Marketing Cloud for nonprofits. Can you speak to the difference between the two? Julie, would you like to take that one?
Sure. Sure. So both are on platform. Both are going to flow data in and out of Salesforce. Both are going to be great tools for generating rich content. Both are going to have really great tools for dynamic content and engagement. Where they differ is how they do it and what types of tools and strategies you have. So we've been talking, you know, Rob has just been covering some of the most fascinating stuff that you can get into in terms of email marketing, because once you get into Marketing Cloud, and we talk about crawl, walk, run, fly. So we don't start out with, you know, advanced automations in our first stages of an implementation. But over time, as your marketing automation programs become more rich, you have a very deep set of tools. So are you needing to import SFTP files on an automated basis? Maybe you have different data systems that are generating files on a nightly basis, and you need to bring them in, do something to tie all the data together, and then take some kind of an action based on that activity. That's hands down, that's Marketing Cloud. Anything where you need to be doing the advanced things like measures, data extracts and file transfers. If you really need to have a very high level of control, that is going to be Marketing Cloud. As well, Marketing Cloud might win for cross-channel. So you've got email, web, mobile, social media marketing, and digital advertising. Those are all, some of those are separate services, but those are in the Marketing Cloud umbrella. Pardot has very much been positioned as the B2B tool. It's been that concept of lead generation, pipeline, and helping to sort of close deals is where that originally came from. So in our nonprofit context, Pardot might win if your lead generation and targeted nurturing is your key, so lead grading and scoring. However, I will say that we can build lead grading and scoring models using customization in Salesforce and Journey Builder and automations. So Pardot might provide all that. Pardot would provide more of that just out of the box. Some really effective nonprofits have both Pardot and Marketing Cloud because they can serve different purposes. Both can help companies and nonprofits meet their goals and fulfill their mission in unique ways. So some have both. And here at Cloud for Good, we have experts on both platforms. So it's that famous, it depends, but I hope those sort of some of those decision points are helpful in thinking through that.
Great. Thank you, Julie. The next question, do you recommend sending data from the Marketing Cloud back to Sales Cloud? If so, are there implications for Sales Cloud storage limits and costs? If not, are there other options for making the data accessible in Sales Cloud, such as external storage? And by data, they're kind of thinking individual email results.
I can
either
speak
one
a
of
little
you
bit.
Want to take a stab? Okay.
Sure. So yes, there. One of the really powerful things that Marketing Cloud offers is tracking email results down to the individual person, and it does that in aggregate across any number of sends that you might be doing. To give you the short answer, yes, there are implications to Sales Cloud storage limits if you are bringing back those individual email results from Marketing Cloud to Salesforce. The benefit of doing that is really having that reporting capability within Salesforce, being able to relate that back to other related records that your contacts may have. A best practice is typically maybe getting rid of those individual email results over time. The Marketing Cloud connector does have a built-in tool to say, you know, maybe individual email results over 3 months old aren't very useful anyway. So you could in bulk delete those records and recover that storage space. There's also the option of just manually exporting that data from Marketing Cloud directly. It's a little more cumbersome to work with, but it is an option if you don't want that data touching your Sales Cloud instance.
Okay, thank you, Rob. I'm going to throw another question at you. How can someone assure that those in EMEA European clients of Marketing Cloud, that Marketing Cloud is GDPR compliant?
Right. So that is relatively new, and I kind of have to defer to Salesforce's statements on this. They do have a GDPR website, salesforce.com/GDPR, where they go platform by platform, Marketing Cloud, Sales Cloud, how they accommodate that. But for Marketing Cloud in particular, there's this notion of the right to be forgotten. And I believe in the start of the summer, they're really going to address maybe streamlining contact deletion across all channels, which is really important. There's a way to do that right now today using things like data extensions and AMP scripts to just manually remove subscribers from the database, which you would require a little bit more configuration, but Salesforce is working on addressing that in a more streamlined way, from my understanding.
All right, great. Thank you, Rob. And I'm going to throw this one at you as well, Rob, since you were talking about higher ed. If I wanted to focus on recruiting and wanted to look at where the interests are coming from in terms of regions and the United States, would DMP be the way to go?
I will admit that we haven't worked a whole lot with DMP just because of the volume of data that's required to really leverage those data science services. If you have a very large amount of data, you'd be able to start building out those kind of profiles of your incoming students or prospective students. But typically, I would recommend just using marketing techniques like maybe progressive profiling to start gathering extra bits of data from those prospective students, which is something you could definitely accommodate using Marketing Cloud in a strategic approach, but also other tools that we didn't mention here like Cloud Pages, to build out landing pages and start accumulating that data to get a better read on your prospective students. The real limitation around DMP and those types of products is really the volume of data that you have available. If you have the means and the data, it's definitely a way to do it, but it's not the only one.
Thank you, Rob. Julie, I'm going to throw this question to you. Could an individual install the connector on their own?
Sure. And actually, I would add another layer to Rob's answer, and I would say if you're focusing on recruiting and you want to know where interests are coming from, it also really depends on how you're defining that. And that goes back to that topic of defining your data model. What's your logic model and how are you capturing that information? So, you know, DMP is one concept, but also there are many others. So you could, however you're capturing that data, that makes it actionable based on, you know, where it lives, how it gets there, what it means, and what you want to do with it. So I would add that there's so many different ways to go about it. We'd have to probably know more about exactly that use case. In terms of configuring that connector, there is documentation for installing the connector. And so you can install that connected app on your own, but that's usually not the trickiest part. So what really needs close attention and understanding is that data model, the flow of how data will flow through the system. So there are a lot of questions to answer before installing the package and just turning on DataStream. The caution we would make is that if someone just started installing that connector and went in and started synchronizing their data sources, you would run the risk of potentially having some issues over time in terms of how that's set up and how the data is flowing in, whether you're creating duplicates or how converted leads are handled. So I would say there's a lot to think about other than just sort of deploying that package.
Great. Thank you, Julie. I have another question that's come in. I'll throw this one to Rob. Is it possible to send text messages in Journey?
Yep, it certainly is. If you have Mobile Studio enabled for your Marketing Cloud instance, it's something you could certainly just, as Julie talked about, it's just another component that you can drag in. It really adds kind of another layer to your communication strategy, because now you can go across more than one channel. You're no longer limited to just the email approach. You can incorporate SMS as well. One thing to caution about there is that the opt-in strategy for text messaging is a little bit different. Typically, we recommend doing kind of a double opt-in just based on the legalities around text messaging. You want to really make sure that your constituents have opted in to that channel a little bit more thoroughly than you would with just email. But it certainly integrates well with all the tools in Marketing Cloud.
Thank you, Rob. And with that, I will give everybody a few minutes back in their day. I do want to encourage you to continue checking the Cloud for Good website for upcoming webinars. On Thursday this week, we will be discussing artificial intelligence with Beth Cantor and Allison Fine, as well as with our CEO, Cal Frankfurt. I think that it's going to be an awesome webinar covering ethical implications as well as bots and just different types of artificial intelligence. So if you're free on Thursday, I encourage you to join. We also have a webinar in April covering fundraising strategies with the Nonprofit Success Pack. Again, a huge thank you to Julie and Rob for sharing all of your knowledge today. And thank you to everyone that joined. We look forward to seeing you at the next one.